It seems to me that there's a bit of data in the background that strongly suggests that John was written earlier than most commentaries say. If you open up a commentary, it will say that John was written probably in the years in the 90s at the end of the first century. I think that Revelation was, but I don't think John was. I think Matthew was written on the back of Mark, and Luke was written on the back of Mark, meaning Mark had a basic amount of material. But John wrote totally apart from the synoptic or same view Gospels. It seems like John is doing something completely different. And I'd like to posit an idea. You kick it around, see if it works for you. The bottom line is, if the date was in the Gospel, then we would go to the wall and defend it as true. But it's not. This isn't the Bible that I'm telling you now. This is my understanding of how we got what's in the Bible in the Gospel of John. First of all, I think it's important that you recognize that in the Gospel of, according to John, the destruction of Jerusalem is not mentioned. That's a fairly important thing. In fact, that's the 9/11 moment. That's the big cataclysmic moment of the disciples' lives. I mean, they saw Jesus crucified, they saw him raised again, they saw him ascended into heaven, and the only thing that would be in their top five along with those things would be the destruction of Jerusalem. So it's not mentioned, it's not even hinted to in the book. But along with that, the geography of the book seems to be geography contemporary to the time of Jesus or early geography. Why do I say that? Because in the destruction, in the fall of the temple in 70, and between 68 and 73, what we call the first revolt against Rome, the important thing to understand is that the landscape of the country changes dramatically. Wiping out the capital, that changes the landscape. Dropping a temple, that changes the landscape. But even more than that, the idea that as John is following Jesus through the story, it looks almost like a diary of events. Now, don't hear that the wrong way. I'm not saying that Jesus is saying something to Peter and John's going, can you repeat that? Because I didn't get that third word you wrote. I don't think he's steno-padding. But I do think that very early on in his apostleship ministry, he began to take some of the early recollections he had of what Jesus did and started to put them down on paper. Parchment, I guess I should say. So it's an early topography. It doesn't seem to suggest the temple has fallen. There's something else. All the language of John seems to be fairly primitive in terms of church language. What do I mean? Well, they're called disciples and not apostles. If this was very late, would you call them apostles what they are now, or would you call them disciples what they were then? Now, maybe John is really good at contextualizing, and what he's trying to do is kind of put you back in the moment by calling them the disciples. But John uses that term frequently, and it's not a term that would be used, say, in 90. It would be a term that would be used in the early career of the apostles as they went out. So they were disciples. Then Jesus went up into heaven, and they became his sent ones, apostello. And their terminology in the church would more be apostle than disciple. That's like their old term. There's also something else. If you look at the Qumran community documents, the ones that are found near the Dead Sea, what you find are a series of documents that are strongly, they have all these Greek and Hellenistic elements to them. 100 years ago, all critical scholars said this. They said, well, because there's such Hellenistic argumentation in John's gospel, it must be that it came much, much later, but that was before the Dead Sea Scrolls. Now we know it was a very Jewish thing to be arguing about Greek concepts and the idea of fatalism. Remember, we told you that long before Calvin, there was Calvinism, and long before Arminius, there was Arminianism. There were already fatalistic and dualistic arguments going on in Judaism, and we only know that because of the Dead Sea Scrolls. So when you take the Dead Sea Scrolls into account, it looks like the first century was filled with some of the very kinds of discussions that John's gospel is going to include. We have a couple of fragments. We don't have a copy of the Gospel of John from John's hand. We don't have the autographs, right? But what we do have are fragments of copies. And two of those fragments, one of them is known as P55, Papyrus 55. And the other fragment, I think that's probably equally important, is named after a person, Papyrus Edgerton. Those two papyri are things that you should know about. These are fragments that include the Gospel of John in them, and Papyrus Edgerton 2 is likely dated no later than about 100. That means we don't have the original, but we've got copies from about 100. Now, what does that tell you? Interestingly enough, we have two unrelated papyri from two different communities in two different places, both referring to John from around 100. What does that tell you? It probably says it's inconceivable that the thing could have been written in the 90s and disseminated that fast into various communities by the 100s in copies. It doesn't mean it can't be. It means it's highly unlikely. The later you put the original, the harder it is to see how it would have spread that quickly over communities far and wide in the Roman Empire that quickly. Things move slowly in Rome compared to what you're used to. Right now, a bomb goes off in Jerusalem and you see it within moments. We have an instantaneous connection. Somebody in China writes a blog article and it disseminates throughout the earth within 24 hours, you can light up the net. And so what's interesting and important for us to understand is that things, it's hard to make a secret. It's hard to keep a secret in the 21st century. Some of you probably don't know this, but the way that we know about the underground supply of natural gas in America is not because the government told us. The way it happened was someone was looking at Google Earth, and they noticed, have you noticed when you have a nighttime view of the Earth, on Google Earth, like if you look at Florida, what lights up are all the cities, right? And then there's dark spaces in between. Someone noticed and called attention to and gave to reporters the information that in North Dakota, where virtually no one lives, the area is lit up at night like it's a city. And they asked the question why. A series of reporters looked into it and found out that the natural gas release is so large in that area that it's easier for them to simply burn it off than try to cap it off at this point. And so they're burning all these wells, and at night it looks like there's a city in North Dakota where there isn't one. Someone checking that by looking at Google Earth sent it to reporters, and that's how we know. The government didn't tell us, it's that we asked them and then they had to come clean with it. It's hard to keep a secret. You're out in the middle of nowhere and you have a gas well and we can find it. If you have a new pool in your backyard, I can Google Earth and eventually within a few months I will be able to spot it. And if you happen to lay by that pool very often, you're liable to show up on Google Earth as well in your swimsuit. The point is that we have something that ancients didn't have. We have the ability to communicate rapidly and broadly across the platforms of the Earth. A guy can be on the space station, make a statement, and you can hear it in the NPR clip of the morning news the following morning. So we're hearing it from space. The biblical person doesn't have that. Would you be open to the idea, I think most of you would from your reading, that John does not appear to be aware of the synoptic gospels? He doesn't appear to be aware of what Matthew, Mark, and Luke say in the order of the story. I'm not saying he says a totally different story. I'm saying when you read John, don't you feel like you're reading a totally different story of the life of Jesus than Matthew, Mark, and Luke? When you read Matthew, Mark, and Luke, wasn't it getting kind of redundant? And by the time you hit Luke, you were going, all right, already, I got it. Okay? But when you get to John, it's almost like a different story. Same guy, same basic idea, but very different storyline. So John doesn't appear to have any dependence on the synoptics. Let's say he has a literary independent document. I think Matthew and Luke had the good fortune of having Mark as their background, and some of the things that they added on top of Mark produced their gospel, but John doesn't appear to have any of that. There's also, by the way, a very strong piece of evidence for an early date for John. Would you take your Bible and go to John 5, verse 2? Somebody read John 5, 1 and 2.
After these things, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having five porticos.
Okay, what I'd like you to underline or circle is there is in Jerusalem, not there was in Jerusalem. That pool was destroyed in 70. Now, that's a pretty, pretty minor statement considering how much I'm hanging on it. But let me say this. In 70, the Bethesda pools were destroyed. For those of you who travel with me to Israel, I will take you there and we will take a look at the Bethesda pools and the excavations of them. We are quite aware of when they were destroyed, how were they were destroyed, and what they looked like and how they functioned. Bottom line is this. In John 5, he seems to be suggesting that they're still there, which gives to me the idea that this could be written in the 60s because it's destroyed in the year 70. Mm-hmm. So we believe that we have a pre-70 date as a suggestion, as a probable date for the Gospel of John, even though most commentators put it much later. I'm going to dispute that. I'm going to say that I think I might know why John wrote his Gospel. And I'm going to take my evidence largely from the gospel itself. In fact, I think John's gospel came together in three steps. I think the first step was that John had kind of the notes of a diary of what he experienced in relationship to Jesus Christ. That would be step one. Then I think he added to that the prologue in 1:1-18, which gives you sort of the opening, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the theology of who Jesus is as the Spirit of God made it known to him. I think he also snapped on the back end of it an epilogue, and I think that the book originally ended with chapter 20, verse 31. Would somebody read 20, 30, and 31, and tell me if it sounds to you like the end of the book?
Performed many other signs Jesus also performed in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these have been written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name.
Now, before you move off of the 20, 30, and 31, you need to know that there's a manuscript problem with the word believe. The word believe may be in a past tense or it may be in a present tense. There are different manuscripts that say it differently. If it's a past tense, it means that you have already believed and keep on believing. And so he's writing the document to believers. If it's in the present tense, which is the way many of us teach it today, it means that you may come to believe. In other words, this is an evangelistic tract, and we want you to believe in Jesus, and you haven't yet necessarily placed your faith and trust in him, but these are written that you would have the essential documents so that you may know how to believe and what to believe in, and in believing have life. Okay? It's a nuance of a difference, but depends on which word for believer, which form of that word it is as to what he's trying to say. My point is, doesn't it sound like in John 20 verses 30 and 31, this sounds like he's kind of wrapping the book up, doesn't it? I mean, you're going to say yes because I told you to, but I mean, I think that's a reasonable sound. Somebody read 21:1.
After these things, Jesus manifested himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, and he manifested himself in this way.
Okay, I'm going to propose that 20, 30, and 31 was the original end of the book, and that the purpose of the book and the timing of the book is revealed in the addition of chapter 21. I think if you read chapter 21, you're going to find that that's the catalyst for why the book is written. Now, what is chapter 21 about? It's about the appearances of Jesus after the resurrection, which I think we all agree are important, but other writers had already written about them. What is essential about 21, what story will help you in 21 that you don't really hear from other places? I'm going to give you a hint. It relates to Peter. I'm sorry? Okay, eating breakfast together will restore Peter before the men, but what else? Okay, you're too early though. You're right, but it's early. Keep going. What happens after that in the Peter story? Where does Peter show up in the chapter? So he's at the 153 fish. He's also at the do you love me? Feed my sheep, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. Then go on. What is the dialogue between Peter after Jesus and Peter are eating breakfast? They finish breakfast. He knows he loves him. Feed my sheep, feed my lambs. What's the rest of the chapter about? What's that?
Peter's death.
Peter's death. I think that's the catalyst for the book. I think what happened was this, guys. Look, set aside all your thinking for a minute and just focus on this. I think what happened was this. John was in Jerusalem. Paul had been traveling across Asia Minor, what you and I would call Turkey. Where's the place that Paul spent the longest in all of his journeys? What city did Paul spend longer in than any other city? Hint, nearly 3 years there.
Rome?
No?
Ephesus.
Ephesus was a Pauline hub. So whether it was Perge or Antalya or Iconium, Lystra, Derbe, or out to the west, the churches of Asia Minor that Revelation is written to, these were largely Pauline churches. They got started by Paul, right? Well, the problem is, right in the mid-60s, Paul gets killed by Nero. Peter seems to pick up and endorse Paul. So Peter writes, Paul was writing scripture. By the way, I don't always understand it, Peter said. He's a little tough to understand, but Peter endorses Paul. Then Peter dies in the mid-60s. And right about then, John leaves Jerusalem and goes to Ephesus and becomes pastor of the Ephesus church. And what I think he found out was that the gospels, they weren't really available to that church. And the church among the largely Gentile community of Paul's outreach needed somebody to endorse Paul's gospel and make sure that the church stayed together around Paul's gospel. In other words, I think what John is doing is he's saying, all right, Pete's dead, Paul's dead, and I'm the last guy standing, and I need to make sure that the gospel is firmly cemented in very careful exposition in front of the church at Ephesus. And Ephesus, remember, is the beginning of the mail route for Western Asia Minor. Because when you drop mail in Ephesus, it goes from Ephesus to Smyrna, from Smyrna to Pergamum, from Pergamum to Thyatira, from Thyatira to Philadelphia, from Philadelphia to Laodicea, from Laodicea to Sardis, and then back to, from Sardis back to Laodicea, and then down to Ephesus. And the point is that the seven churches of Revelation 2 and 3 are in the order of the postal route. That's why they're written that way. First to this church, then to that church, because that's the way the mail route went. And the point is that these churches were largely evangelized by Paul. Paul's the one who did the work. Paul's dead. Nero kills Paul. And when Nero kills Paul, John leaves Jerusalem. And we have early church evidence from the, what are called the patristic fathers, the church, early church fathers, that say John left in a hurry out of Jerusalem and went to Ephesus. What did he do that for? Because when Peter died in Rome, when Paul was executed outside of Rome, it left a big gap in Western Asia Minor and the main places where the church was growing. I believe the Gospel of John got its 21st chapter and its finishing touches and was sent out as the Gospel of John to those churches after John became the pastor at the Ephesus church and after Peter and Paul were dead. And I think what he was trying to do was underwrite the understanding of what the gospel really is. So we have three stages of composition. Make sure you understand these. The first stage of composition is really John's diary, the diary of John. The second stage of composition seems to be snapping on a prologue in chapter 1, verses 1 to 18, and an epilogue at the end of chapter 20, verses 30 and 31. So we've got now a second stage. The third stage seems to me to be the final completion and sending of the book out into the mail. And when he did that, he added chapter 21. And the catalyst for it was Peter's death. And that's why chapter 21 is about who Peter was and how Jesus promised, the sovereignty of God promised that Peter would be executed. You understand the logic behind that? The fact that Jesus said, Peter, you're going to die, means that Peter's death was no longer a surprise because the people in the church thought it was. Why should they believe in Jesus? The leaders are all getting killed. And the reason is because the leader, Jesus, told us that's what was going to happen. And so the evidence of the death of the disciples or apostles becomes an evidence for Jesus, not an evidence against his message. Does that make sense? If he promised it ahead of time, it means he's got the whole world in his hands, as the Negro spiritual said. So it seems to me that after Paul dies in the mid-60s and then Peter is killed, it's interesting because John intends to end the gospel, I think, with chapter 20. But in chapter 21, he puts on a final chapter. Why did he do it? Because 2 Peter chapter 1, and you should put this next to John 21. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 15 gives a clue. Here's the clue. 2 Peter 1, 15. Now I'm eager that each of you have a memorial of these things after my departure. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 15 suggests that after Peter departed, there would be another writing that would give authenticity to what he's saying. Does that make sense to you? You might want to write in, go to 2 Peter chapter 1. And let me just suggest to you that I would put the note, 2 Peter 1:15, that may be that Peter hikes the ball to John and says, John, if in the event, in the likely event that I lose my life by crucifixion upside down, according to early church scholars, in the event that I am crucified and I can no longer lead the church, I need you to make sure that the gospel is firmly rooted in the Western churches, including Rome, Corinth, and Ephesus. These are going to be mainstay churches, and I need you to make sure that this gospel gets out. And I think in 2 Peter chapter 1, he says, I know there's going to be a memorial after my, there's going to be something written that helps you to understand this after my departure. I don't think it's Peter sitting on a rock looking up into heaven all zen-like. I think he sent a message to John to do it. I think he knew John was closing in on the end of his gospel, and I am frankly making that up. I don't know that. It just looks to me like there's a connection. Is it possible that John 21 is the memorial of 2 Peter 1:15? It seems to me that it is. That the appendix that they're going to, you know, that John is going to work into his gospel the story of Peter so that people don't give up their faith, but rather understand it as something predictive. John wanted to give Paul's churches the gospel. John wanted to help them after Paul died. John wanted to make sure that Peter's death was understood by the early church to be something Jesus said. So, entirely apart from the consideration of Peter's death, I want you to also know that there's something else. We have a tradition of John's early residence in Ephesus. So we're almost certain that the Gospel of John comes from Ephesus as a city. Pen of John, city of Ephesus. Pen of John, city of Ephesus. The other thing is that early church literature tells us clearly that he left there somewhere around 65. So we don't need it to be a late one to be from Ephesus and from his pen. I think one of the things we have to be able to say is, who do you think John's gospel is written to? Does it seem like it's written to Jews or Gentiles? Majority. Well, if you said Gentiles, your evidence would be he often explains Jewish things. Like John 2, he says, these pots were sitting outside the house at Cana, and that water is used for the purification of the Jews. Would you say that if you were writing to Jews? It sounds like you're explaining things that everybody would know. You know, well, that offering plate was taken up so that they could get the offering of the church. You wouldn't write that to a group of people who were in a church. They'd go, well, duh. Why are you wasting my time with that? I know that. However, there are evidences in the book also that there's some understanding of Jewish background. So let me suggest to you that the answer is both. And I want to break it down for you just very quickly and see if we can kind of understand what he had done. First, let's just think very carefully about what's in the Gospel of John. My study of the Gospel of John in my early years as a believer was a formative study. What I did was, John Kaywood from what was then Philadelphia College of the Bible was the one who pulled me aside, and I had said to him, Dr. Kaywood, I don't understand how you can just rattle off passages of Scripture. And he said, well, let me tell you the single greatest thing that Dr. Hendricks told me when I was at Dallas Seminary. He said, the single greatest thing I ever learned was how to study the Bible. I said, okay, well, how do you study the Bible? He said, well, here's the thing. People are going to give you all kinds of complex methods. Let me tell you the one I used. And this is the one I used, the one from my teacher, the one from his teacher. It was very simple. I spent 30 days reading the first 7 chapters of the Gospel of John. Every day for 30 days, I read 7 chapters of the Gospel of John. Then the next 30 days, I picked up John 8 and read the next 7 chapters of the Gospel of John. And for every day for 30 days, I read the next 7 chapters of the Gospel of John. And then the third set of 30 days, I read the last 7 chapters of the Gospel of John. There are 21 chapters in the Gospel. By the end of 3 months, I could tell you that in John 1, Jesus gets his first 5 followers and makes a whip. I could tell you that in John 2, there was a wedding at Cana. In John 3, Nicodemus. In John 4, a woman at the well. In John 5, there was a pools of Bethesda. In John 6, they were fed by a little boy's lunchbox. In John 7, 8, 9, and first half of 10, Jesus goes to the Feast of Tabernacles. In the second half of 10, he comes back for Hanukkah. In John 11, I could tell you that he came for the raising of Lazarus to Jerusalem. And in John 12, he came for the triumphal entry. And in John 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17, it's the last night teachings of Jesus. In John 18, verse 1, he ended up at Gethsemane and was arrested there. And by John 19, he goes through a series of trials and questionings before Annas and Caiaphas and the Sanhedrin, and then between Pilate and Herod, and then Pilate. And I could tell you that by 20, he is on the cross, and then he is raised from the dead. And in 21:19, he dies on the cross. 20, he is raised. And in 21, you have the story of Peter. How did I do that? I read it for 90 days. That's how I did that. At the end of it all, guys, with all the sophisticated methodology, read it. How shocking. You mean I can learn the Bible by reading it? Yes, I don't know anything more effective than reading it so much that you know. I could tell you in my old Bible that the woman at the well was the bottom of the right-hand corner. I knew where it was on the page. Now, how meaningful was day 26 when you're reading it 30 times? Did I like richly get something out of it? Yes and no. I wasn't trying to find how does it relate to me. I was just trying to find what does it say. Let me tell you what we've done to rob you. Sunday school Christianity has gotten you so used to finding what it means that you don't even read what it says. Before you worry about what it means, make sure you're a master of what it says. When you've mastered what it says, then you can tell me what it means. My problem is, it doesn't mean what it doesn't say, okay? So, in John's gospel, I just ran through 21 chapters with you in order for you to see what he does with skipping a stone across the top of the pond. But that's not what I think is the essential argument of the book. Remember I told you early on that there are two different ways of thinking in the Jewish and Gentile world. Let me quiz you out loud. In Judaism, in Hebrew mindset, you are what you
do.
In Greek mindset, in the Gentile world, you are defined by what you
say.
All right. So John is going to give you 7 I am sayings that will satiate or fill up the empty soul of the Gentile and tell you, this is what Jesus said. So a Gentile would go, well, if that's what he said, I understand his philosophy or what he's about. And for the Jewish audience, they're going to go, I don't care what he said. I care what he did. And so there will be 7 I do confirmation works of Jesus in the gospel. There are 7 of one and 7 of the other. Follow my line of thinking because I'm going to do this quickly. The 7 I am sayings very quickly are these. For a Greek mindset, Jesus said in John chapter 6, verse 35, I am the bread of life. And do you remember that there were two elements on every table that represented your needs and God's faithfulness? The bread represents your need. Give us this day our daily bread is give us this day what we need. So bread equals need in the Bible. What does the wine equal? He gave wine for the joys of men, it says in Psalms. So the needs are your bread, the joys are your wine. In other words, I can thank God for providing for me transportation, but he didn't only provide for me transportation, he provided for me transportation that Bluetooths to my phone when I get in it. So what is that, bread or cup? That's a cup blessing. Bread is that I have transportation. Cup is that it has Bluetooth and air conditioning. What? So I bless God for the bread that he gave me what I needed, but I thank God for the cup that he gave me way cool stuff because he's a way cool God and didn't just give me what I needed. I have, and fill in the blank of all the cool things he's given you, okay? So when he says I'm the bread of life, I am what you need. That is what he's trying to say, John 6, 35. I am what you need. Second one. There is a woman. She is found in the case of adultery, and something fishy this way smells. There is no man in the story, and the man who is given charge over the opportunity to throw the first stone at the woman, if he's the one offended according to law, he is not there. He is not in the scene. Apparently, she has been found, but there is no male with her. And her husband, who has been deeply offended by her adultery, does not seem to be present or willing to throw the first stone. So they come to Jesus and they ask him, what should we do? And he's writing something on the ground. What I happen to think he's writing is the names of all the people they've all had adulterous relationships with, which I think scares the bejeebies out of them. At any rate, he turns to them and says, let him who is without sin cast the first stone. And they all drop their rocks and walk away. And Jesus says in John 8, 12, I am the light of the world. Light in the Bible, in this context, will mean knowledge, will mean complete exposure. And that is, I tell the truth. I light up the truth. No bugs here that don't get spotted because I turn the light on and find all the bugs. When the light goes on, the roaches scatter. And so what he did was he turned on the light and they all scattered. I'm using the roaches in the Ezekiel sense, you know, the vermin and bugs crawling in the temple. That's what I'm doing there. A little biblical humor for you. Yeah, come on. One of you got it. Anyway. All right, a little bit later on, he's now dealing with a man who has been healed in John 10. He's been healed during the Feast of Tabernacles. And because he had the audacity in John chapter 9 to get his blindness taken away at the wrong time, silly man, what is he doing getting eyesight from his blindness on a Sabbath? What is his problem? Because of that, Jesus says, I am the door to the sheep. And the point of the door to the sheep is you guys are trying to block people out. I'm trying to get people who you don't want in. I am the door to the sheep. That's John 10, verses 8 and 9. And it's based on the John 9 healing. It's the same context and same person. A little bit later, John 10, verse 11. Not only am I the door to the sheep, I'm the good shepherd. Where does that come from? How many of you remember a passage about shepherds of Israel? Come on, somebody help me act like you know what I'm talking about. What's that? There's lots of them. What's the one that's related to John the Baptizer's ministry? Right, class, Ezekiel 34 and following, I will send a good shepherd. In fact, I will shepherd my people myself, it says, because of the evil shepherds.
What's the reference on the good shepherd?
You want John 10, 11. And John 10, 11 stacks up against Ezekiel 34 and following. It's 34 to 37 and the story of, I'm going to put on skin and come there and shepherd my own people since you did such a lousy job of shepherding them. You do not understand John 10, verse 11, if you do not read Ezekiel 34 and understand the promise God made. Okay, how about John? Oh, go ahead.
So what does the Good Shepherd mean?
Because Good Shepherd is about two things. It's about Jesus making an overt claim in front of the Pharisees and Sanhedrin that the evil shepherds, i.e. them, were directing the people in a way that was pushing them out of the kingdom, and he had come to shepherd them in. The second thing it is the more basic story of you guys disenfranchise people, and I get people who you disenfranchise and draw them into the kingdom. We're about two opposite ministries.
So it's the same thing.
I'm sorry?
It's the same thing.
Yes, exactly. It's just two ways of looking at the principle, one general and one more specific. John 11, with the raising of Lazarus, you have the fifth of the saying. So I am the bread of life, the light of the world, the door of the sheep, the good shepherd. John 11, I am the resurrection and the life. And this is a discussion with Jesus and his friends. He's having a discussion now. Remember, Martha has come to him. And they're having a little theological discussion about resurrection and the end time. And he said, I am the resurrection and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And the exclusivity of Jesus' message is brought home by John from the interview of the Mary, Martha, Lazarus story of John 11. And then finally, you have two more. John 14, which is now an upper room saying. John 13 and 14, go ahead.
John 11 what?
25. Somebody check that, make sure that's right. John 11, 25, yes. Now I can say with great emphasis because Ashley has told me I am true. John 11, 25, make it so. All right, John 14, 6. Do you remember John 13 and 14 are in the upper room? John 15, 16, and 17 are on the walk of the last night in which Jesus is betrayed. John 18 is when he's arrested. So John 13 and 14 in the upper room, John 14, 6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. The issue in John 14 is a very simple issue. The issue is that he's now told them about his wedding. He said, I'm going away to build onto my Father's house, and if I go, I will come again, receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. You guys, you know about weddings. I'm leaving. I'm going to go get married, right? You're going to come and join me, but it's not going to happen until your place is ready. I'm not ready for you yet. There has to be a story play out on earth before I come and get my bride. So currently, we are the betrothed to Jesus, not the married to Jesus. We are not the bride of Christ yet. We are the promised bride of Christ. We are the betrothed bride of Christ. We become the bride when the bridegroom comes and takes us home. Right now, we're under the law of a bride, as you know. But we are not under the full understanding or the full consummation of a bride. Then in John 15, verse 1, this is the beginning of the walk. John 15, verse 1, I am the true vine. If you remain in me, you will produce fruit. If you do not remain in me, I will use your life for heat. I will prune you away, and I will use your life for heat. And it's not that it's not useful, it's not that it's not helpful, but I want you to be fruitful over and over and over. That's what I want from your life. So he's the one who makes me useful. Let me say it this way. If I were a Greek, I would have heard this. Jesus said, I am what you need. I'm the bread of life. I'm the one who turns the light on to the truth and doesn't let you live in error and darkness. I'm the light of the world. I'm the one who gives you access and protection and draws you in from your state of Gentile defection from God as an alien. I make you part of the household of God, see, because I'm the door of the sheep. I'm the one who gathers together my people and in righteousness, but in gentleness, makes them have a place. I am the good shepherd. By the way, it doesn't matter if they take my life from me, because I am the resurrection and the life. And the one who believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me will never die. And he says, by the way, I am the way, the truth, the life. There is no other option. I'm not one of the ways to get to God. I am it. And by the way, I can make your life useful if you will remain in me. So the benefits of your belief don't only start after you're dead. They start right now, if you'll walk with me. If I were a Jew, I would want to know, so what did he do? I like that you told me what he said, but what did he do? Well, here's what he did. John chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. He took the ordinary water and made it extraordinary and turned it into wine. Water into wine is ordinary to extraordinary. And what does it say? He is the transformer, more than meets the eye. Jesus will transform your life. And it doesn't matter who you are, it matters what he can do when he touches it. And if you're in John 4, verses 46 to 54, that's the second thing he did. Remember the long distance healing? You remember the story behind that? The long distance healing is Jesus is up at Cana, where he's very popular ever since he's made water into wine. And a man from Capernaum, an official, John 4, 46 to 54, walks up the 8 1/4 hours up the slope to go see Jesus because he's got a child that's dying. Jesus says, go home, your kid's fine. The next day, the man's running down the side of the hill and the slaves come up to him and say, your son is made well. He said, what day, how did it happen? When did it happen? He said, 1 o'clock yesterday, the fever broke and he's fine. I'm adding some details to the story. And the point is that the man believed Jesus' words so well that when he could have gotten back in 5 hours, he didn't go home. He saw Jesus at 1 o'clock in the afternoon and took the rest of the day off. Why? There was no reason to rush. Jesus said his son was well. And the writer expects you to understand the geography, the terrain, the distance. It's 8 1/4 hours up. It's about 5 hours and 10 minutes down the hill, and I'm a fast walker. I've done that hill a number of times. Usually down, seldom up. Why? I'm not stupid. Why walk up, okay? When you can walk down and see the same sights. The point is that this man, long distance, has his child healed. Why does Jesus include this? Why does John include this in the story of Jesus? To let you know something. Not only can he change the ordinary into the extraordinary, but what is it he desires? He desired one thing from that man, trust. Trust my word and I will do. See, for the Jew who wants the action, John responds, yes, but Jesus wants your trust in his word, not just in what happens to you today. See, the downfall of trusting in the actions is if things aren't going well, your faith can be destabilized. However, if you trust in his word, what difference does it make if it's going well today? Because he said that he is at work in your life. It doesn't matter whether it seems to be working today. How about this? In John 5, 1, he goes up to a lame man at Bethesda, and the lame man says, sir, I have no one to help me. What's the point of the story? Jesus is the helper to the one who has no one. Flip past it to John 6, verses 6 to 13. Jesus has been preaching, people are hungry, disciples are nosing in lunchboxes. Jesus says, what are we going to do about lunch? They say, well, there's a kid over there in the second row, and we know what's in his lunchbox because we weren't paying attention to what you were preaching. We were looking through people's lunchboxes, and he's got these loaves and these fishes. And what does Jesus do with them? He multiplies them to feed the crowd. And what's the point of the story? Little becomes much when Jesus touches it. It's not about what you bring to it. It's about what he brings to it that makes it much. Ministry isn't what you can do for Jesus. It's what he can do through you, if you'll get out of the way and let him do it. But Jesus is never lacking supplies. That's one of the things you should know. So the point of the loaves and fishes is that Jesus is never lacking supplies. He never has a problem getting what he needs. But by the way, after that, he gets in the boat and he calms the storm. And what's the point? There is no power. There is no obstacle Jesus cannot surmount. 6:16-21. His power is unlimited. And then if you fast forward a couple of chapters, you get all the way into chapter 9. We're back at the pool of Siloam, where Jesus has been speaking. And when he comes, he heals a blind man who no one paid attention to. No church leader, and let me say it that way, no temple leader paid attention to this man until after he could see. Then they had to bring in testimony. Is this really the guy? Yes, he's really the guy. And the parents go, yes, he's really our child. And then he, in chapter 9, he walks them through. Look, I didn't know who Jesus was. He came and he healed me. I don't know why you guys have a chip on your shoulder about him, but here's the thing. Jesus' healing of that man took a man who had nothing to offer Jesus whatsoever, and he brought him into the kingdom, and he turned the light on and gave him a life, because that's what Jesus does. When Jesus takes your dark heart and lights it up, he gives you a life, and you live forevermore. And until he opens your eyes and until you see the truth, you're stumbling around in the dark and you don't know what life is for. So the Jew should walk away with, he lights up that darkness in me and allows me to see real life. And the last one, in the raising of Lazarus, is the last act in the book that Jesus does to show who he is, the seventh one. And what is that? He takes the dead, lifeless body of Lazarus as the king over death and calls him from beyond in the spirit world and regenerates the cells in his body, because Colossians 1:16-17 said, of him and to him and through him are all things created, and in him all things consist. And Jesus only needed to say, Lazarus, get up and come out of here. I'm going to tell you that I believe with all of my heart, Lazarus had a harder time getting out the door than Jesus had raising him. I think it was physically harder for Lazarus all wrapped up to get out the door than it was for Jesus to turn his lifeless body into life. Why? Because that's nothing for the author of life. Jesus didn't go, let me really whip up a, I'm going to work up a sweat now. Lazarus, Lazarus, come forth. I don't think, and then he went, oh. I think he said, Lazarus, get up. And he did. I think it was harder for Lazarus to get out the door. I think there was more human effort on Lazarus's side than there was on Jesus's side. I think when you're the Prince of Life and you have the death and life in your hands, and the keys to death and the grave are in your hands, it's no big deal for you to turn a key. I realize that if you're among primitives and you take out a key and open a door, they may go, ooh, you have such power. But for the rest of us, we got lots of keys and you're not really doing anything big. Jesus took the key to death and said, okay, open up. And I think it was that clear. So, if you're a Jew, you would have heard, from water into wine, he can change me. He can transform me. From the long distance healing, what he desires is my trust. From the lame man of Bethesda, he'll take the helpless person and give them help. From the loaves and the fishes, he has no exhaustion to the capabilities. He's never running short on supplies. He calms the storm because his power is unlimited. He opens and turns the light on to the dark eyed person and gives them life forevermore, because that's what he does. And by the way, don't worry about death, because he's conquered death. And I think if you're a Jew or a Gentile, these seven things, seven I am's, seven I do's, tell the story of who he is. And how does it all wrap up? At the end of John 20. Lots of other things Jesus did. But these were written that you might believe, and in believing have life.
Don't lose heart, I